Blackstone Audio presents Institutes of the Christian Religion by John Calvin, translated by Henry Beveridge. This book is read by Bob Souer. Original Translator's Preface, 1581. Prefixed to the 4th edition, 1581, and reprinted verbatim in all the subsequent editions. Thomas Norton, the translator, to the reader. Good reader, here is now offered you, the fourth time printed in English, Mr. Calvin's book of the Institutes of Christian Religion, a book of great labor to the author, and of great profit to the Church of God. Mr. Calvin first wrote it when he was a young man, a book of small volume, and since that season he has, at sundry times, published it with new increases, still protesting at every edition himself to be one of those qui scribendo proficiunt et proficiendo scribunt, which with their writing do grow in profiting, and with their profiting do proceed in writing. At length having, in many of his other works, travailed about exposition of sundry books of the Scriptures, and in the same finding occasion to discourse of sundry commonplaces and matters of doctrine, which, being handled according to the occasions of the text that were offered him, and not in any other method, were not so ready for the reader's use, he therefore entered into this purpose to enlarge this book of Institutes, and therein to treat of all those titles and commonplaces largely, with this intent, that whensoever any occasion fell in his other books to treat of any such cause, he would not newly amplify his books of commentaries and expositions therewith, but refer his reader wholly to this storehouse and treasure of that sort of divine learning. As age and weakness grew upon him, so he hastened his labor, and, according to his petition to God, he in manner ended his life with his work, for he lived not long after. So great a jewel was meet to be made most beneficial, that is to say, applied to most common use. Therefore, in the very beginning of the Queen's Majesty's most blessed reign, I translated it out of Latin into English for the commodity of the Church of Christ, at the special request of my dear friends of worthy memory, Reginald Wolfe and Edward Whitchurch, the one of Her Majesty's printer for the Hebrew, Greek, and Latin tongues, the other Her Highness's printer of the Books of Common Prayer. I performed my work in the house of my said friend, Edward Whitchurch, a man well known of upright heart and dealing, an ancient, zealous gospeler, as plain and true a friend as ever I knew living, and as desirous to do anything to common good, especially by the advancement of true religion. At my said first edition of this book, I considered how the author thereof had of long time purposely labored to write the same most exactly, and to pack great plenty of matter in small room of words, yes, and those so circumspectly and precisely ordered, to avoid the cavillations of such as for enmity to the truth therein contained would gladly seek and abuse all advantages which might be found by any oversight in penning of it, that the sentences were thereby become so full as nothing might well be added without idle superfluity, and again so highly paired that nothing could be minished without taking away some necessary substance of matter therein expressed. This manner of writing, besides the peculiar terms of arts and figures, and the difficulty of the matters themselves being throughout interlaced with the schoolmen's controversies, made a great hardness in the author's own book, in that tongue wherein otherwise he is both plentiful and easy, insomuch that it suffices not to read him once, unless you can be content to read in vain. This consideration encumbered me with great doubtfulness for the whole order and frame of my translation. If I should follow the words, I saw that of necessity the hardness in the translation must needs be greater than was in the tongue wherein it was originally written. If I should leave the course of words, and grant myself liberty after the natural manner of my own tongue, to say that in English which I conceived to be his meaning in Latin, I plainly perceived how hardly I might escape error, and, on the other side, in this matter of faith and religion, how perilous it was to error. For I dared not presume to warrant myself to have his meaning without his words, and they that know what it is to translate well and faithfully, especially in matters of religion, do know that not the only grammatical construction of words suffices, but the very building and order to observe all advantages of vehemence or grace, by placing or accent of words, makes much to the true setting forth of a writer's mind. In the end,
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.